Okay, good morning. Today is Thursday, February 15, 2024. Already in the middle of February, moving right along. And this is class 16 in the series Patanjali and Buddha Dhamma. And this is going deeper and deeper. So, as a hopefully, a little bit brief or concise summary or overview of where we've been and where we are. Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga, the eight limbs, leading to the summit, which is Samadhi. And Samadhi basically as one-pointedness and calm abiding or equanimity in concentrated or alert, attentive, non-grasping awareness in the moment, in a as a steady state, is then the platform, not the end of the path, but the platform for a rising of finer states, as he said, and then setting them aside. The setting them aside is where we find some interface or crossover with Buddhist teaching and Buddha Dhamma teaching, original Pali Buddhism, particularly the three marks or three characteristics, which are anicca-anatta-dukkha, impermanence, no self, and stress or dissatisfactoriness, dukkha, commonly translated as pain, but it's much more subtle than raw pain. Those marks or characteristics, according to Gautama's teaching, and I think one does find in practice, represent a deeper recognition, a deeper level of understanding phenomena, all phenomena, than the surface, than the common or default level of understanding or content of knowing. So, like last time, we're talking about non-dual epistemology. Meaning, the theory of knowledge in accord with non-duality or the law of one. The law of one is the initial understanding of non-duality. Non-duality is beyond two or one, but the law of one, realization that all is one, inner, outer, past, present, future, all polarity is simply seen as polarity by way of our limited perception. There's a physical, there's a metaphysical, we only see the physical, but that and that's a polarity when and we see it as a we see polarity by limited perception. And so we're talking about levels of knowing here. Finer states only arise in samadhi, finer states like the higher jhanas, finer states where non-duality is becoming more apparent, like the four higher jhanas, because when Buddhism understands the eight jhanas, the eight trances, the eight levels of meditation, one can say there's no contradiction between that and Patanjali's understanding of higher states that come up in samadhi, as far as I can tell, and any kind of real hardened conflict, particularly between Advaita Vedanta and Buddha Dhamma, is commonly the result of people who don't want to be inclusive, who get some power by saying no to the other, when actually the truth is they're speaking the same truths, the same matters in different vocabulary. And that's another matter. So one is levels of perception or levels of knowing. There's a common level of knowing or outer. There's deeper knowing, which could be called an inner. And then there is transcendence of conceptual knowing, which could be called secret. So outer, inner, secret. It's a Tibetan triad there, doctrinal principle. Many times, reality is an outer, can be understood, or phenomena can be understood at these three levels. These are three simple, this is a it's a system that indicates the fact of there being levels of knowing. And what we call outer is common perceptual, for quite dualistic. What we call inner is the metaphysical, the energy fields, the causal basis, the multifactorial, the complexity of multiple systems and fields and processes always in play. This is an inner to what we see as a kind of static life by our visual, by seeing and hearing. It's basically seeing, hearing, and then thinking. That's outer. The inner is the more subtle, and the secret is beyond conceptual, as far as I can tell. And absolutely, Advaita Vedanta as non-dual Vedanta, and the ba is quite harmonic with in Buddhism the trans the Buddha Dhamma, the transit from samadhi to prajna, or prajna, panya. So sila, samadhi, prajna, right? Virtue, ethics, discipline, morality, restraint, panchashila, the five or the ten, like very similar to Ten Commandments. In Patanjali's system, that's yama niyama, restraints and observances, what to do, what not to do, how not to get into trouble and hurt self or other. But then that goes to samadhi and that goes to prajna, and then from samadhi to prajna, the systems are really remarkably resonant. And so we went from an understanding that in samadhi, the top of the Ashtanga Yoga, or the goal of Ashtanga Yoga, as development of samadhi, so that then one gets to this citta vritti nirodha, the nirodha or cessation or stilling of citta vritti or deep mind agitation, disturbance, monkey mind, the deeper levels of mind that disturb, that lead to instability of the conscious mind. Stilling that by samadhi, one is now in the transit from samadhi to prajna or panya, which is the finer states arising and they're being set aside, and they're set aside significantly, the finer states, the four higher jhanas particularly, if not those, the emerging reality of non-duality, the emerging that the way I've conceived that the world is not the same, or reality, or self, all phenomena is not the same as I've been conceiving it. Things are not as they have appeared to me. I've been a bit mistaken in my apprehension of reality by my conception. And that's where we get anicca-anatta dukkha, impermanence, insubstantiality, or no self, and stress, as a means of seeing, going from the outer to the inner. Phenomena that I thought were stable, actually I find are in unstable, transitory anicca. Phenomena that I considered good and satisfactory, I find are actually not satisfactory because they pass away rapidly and I can't hold it. And that's stressful itself. And so the teaching of dukkha. And then eventually, no self or anatta, all that I considered I see isn't. And so that's actually only broken at the by the Arahant, and that's the eighth fetter, and that's way down the line. And then there's this higher triad that we talked about before, where anicca-anatta dukkha, impermanent as the counteract, impermanence, no self, and stress as a simple way of translating anicca-anatta dukkha. One must de-reify or empty of any apparent substantiality, solidity, those realizations as well. And so impermanence is not a thing. No self is not a thing. Stress is not a thing. actually they're all empty of substantiality, and that's where you get the teaching of sunya. So you have sunya then, and ta-ta-ta, and tamayata, the higher triad from Anicca-Nattadhokkha, which is basically applying, is using this, is the same process of higher of finer states arising and being set aside. The setting aside of our of the common level of perception, the outer, that phenomena are relatively static. I am a substantial me, and pleasure is stable, and there can be pleasure without pain. There can be happiness without stress, or I can get rid of it. All of those outer level, common, superficial, first level beliefs or experiences, right? We perceive and then believe that experience that we're perceiving. They're all insubstantial. And so we shouldn't, and the term is reify, not to reify, to make a concept a thing, to mistakenly substantialize the teachings of Anicca-Nattadhokkha. And they're emptied of any mistaken, imputed substantiality. Like, there isn't a substantial no self. There isn't actually a thing called impermanence. Dukkha too is not substantial, although obviously we do experience stress a lot. The nature of dukkha too is insubstantial, and those are the teachings of sunya. Meanwhile, as we read before, something's happening here. And it's not that there nothingness is insubstantial too. That's a state of mind called nothingness. Let me just see who's running on my computer. I'm sensitive to spinning fan or fan and spinning CPU, but now it's quiet again. Things run silently and then not silently in the background periodically. So, okay, we can empty out our attachment, or we can weaken our attachment to the first level of knowing, the outer, thinking that phenomena and self, our sense of self, are all substantial and static, and that there can be some abiding well-being without dissatisfaction, ever. To think that, you know, there can be a I can attain by my desiring, by me, I, the personhood, which is insubstantial, that's called anatta, can grasp and hold and keep happiness. That's not true, too. That's understood with the truth of dukkha. And then this sense of self is a sense of self, not a substantial identity. That is emptied out also by sunya. Meanwhile, something is speaking, something is listening, someone, some presence, some beingness is speaking and listening and perceiving, seeing and hearing and thinking. Something, some real, apparently, you know, there's some phenomenal process happening here, you know. There's some kind of, there's some reality to an inner and an outer. It may be illusory and conceptually overwritten. We overwrite reality by concept. We tag and label, and thus actually don't see, don't know reality by our continual perception, conception process. But something's going on here, and that's associated with the teaching of ta-ta-ta, suchness, thusness, as it is, which goes all the way to the end. And that's why you have Om Tat Sat, or that mantra, Om Tat Sat, that Om is such, Om is Tat and Sat, or creation or reality, is of the infinite nature of being as it is such, and an ultimate reality beyond subject object, beyond illusion, that can be realized. And so then that's ta-ta-ta that goes all the way to the end. And then atamayata as non-fashioning or not non-identification. In the end, one must not even fashion the relative truths of anicca anatta dukkha. One must get beyond any fashioning associated with sunyata or sunya and ta-ta-ta. One must not conceptualize emptiness or mistakenly substantialize, reify the teaching of anicca anatta dukkha, nor the teaching of ta-ta-ta and sunyata, emptiness and suchness. Ta-ta-ta is suchness, sunyata is emptiness. These are tools, these are medicinal compounds to cure, particularly the first level of setting aside finer states. The first means of setting, one must set aside one's means of setting aside. Finer states arise, and in samadhi, one gets a sense that a sense of, particularly the infinity of space, infinity of consciousness, infinity or bound, truth of nothingness. This sense that time and space time and space are as they are, but our perceptions have been profoundly limiting. And when those perceptions, the doors of perceptions, are cleansed, or perceiving lessons, then there's some sense that my experience of I'm here and you're there is faulty. And my experience that time is now and not yesterday and tomorrow, that's the result of limited perception too. And so the finer states and also nothingness, that all that appears to be substantial, can also be realized as nothing or empty of anything. And thus there's some idea there is nothing as a teaching tool. That's a moving from the outer to the inner, but the inner must be a set aside too. And so sunya helps us set aside the means of setting aside the outer view. So we have an outer, inner, and secret. The teachings of anicca anatta dukkha help us set aside the common perception experience. The teachings of sunya and ta-ta-ta help us set aside the medicine and realize that there's nothing substantial either to impermanence, no self, and stress. There is not a thing called no self. There is not a fixed reality of no self. There's not a fixed reality to impermanence either. Because actually, all that we're conceiving or experiencing as radically impermanent is insubstantial. There's no abiding thing that's in flux. It's the play of light. Ra said, you're not living in a material universe, you're dancing thoughts. And so we're moving to radical non-dual knowing. And as far as I can tell, this is akin to the summit of the mountain or the end of the path, nirvana and moksha, and the end of this all and reincarnation and craving and ignorance. Both Advaita Vedanta and core Buddha Dhamma know that goal, and it's the same goal. Now, when we, because atamayata, while a Buddhist phrase and rare, at the heart of it is the teaching of Maya. Atamayata, the Maya as illusion in the Vedic Sanskrit system, right? It's all Maya. Maya is Maya too, meaning the illusory nature of what we took to be abiding and substantial, that illusory nature is insubstantial too. So then what's going on? Well, it's beyond conceiving. And so this is the higher levels, and it's not relevant if we're dealing with, you know, body illness and relationship problems and financial problems and work problems and life problems, of course. But when we're talking about where this all goes, and it may be helpful to, when talking about where this all goes, this is where it all goes, to some kind of final release from all ignorance, beyond outer, inner, into the final awareness, which can't be conceived, and surely is not the same as our conceiving of inconceivability, like Anicca Anatta Dukkha. So many Buddhists can't get out of Anicca Anatta Dukkha because they haven't done enough practice and realize the truth of sunya. Anicca Anatta Dukkha, the three marks, are empty of substantiality. So there is no solid no self. Buddhists say there's no self. That's as if that's a thing. There was never a self, so there's never a no self too. And there's never been abiding, so there's really no impermanence either. Apparent permanence, you know, apparent substantiality is counteracted by the teaching of impermanence. Apparent substantiality and apparent abiding is the common way, the outer level of perception. That's broken down by Anicca Anatta Dukkha. It's inconstant, and there's not a self there, and it's really stressful, actually. Any tendency to think that those are substantial, there really is impermanence. There really is a no self. There's a no self. What's a no self? Well, if there's never been a self, there's never been a no self. If there have never been substantial phenomena, there's no substantiality to impermanence either. What is it? Well, Om Tat Sat, or Tat Tat Ta, suchness, thusness. Om Tat Sat, it is as it is, ultimate reality is such, independent of subject-object dualistic conception. Now that is very high level, but one can know it increasingly, not just talk about it. And that's the goal, is to know what's beyond the medicine, which is the way we get out of common ignorant believing our limited perceptions. And the top of the line, Advaita Vedanta and Gautama, I would say, are in total agreement, as Buddhadasa Bhikkhu in Suttatthani would probably agree. So on the movement from the interplay between late Indian Buddhism, 500 to 1,000 years after Gautama, 0 to 500, 600, 700 Common Era, or AD, we see the development of Advaita Vedanta heavily influenced by Buddhism. And maybe that's actually why there's so much interface and why we see some of the same terms. So on the Wikipedia page on Gaudapada, who may well have been the teacher, Adi Shankara's teacher's teacher, we see, I'm just going to take snippets so that next time we can get into the teachings a little more. When we're talking about Gaudapada, we're talking about the roots of Adi Shankara, Advaita Vedanta, the roots of Advaita Vedanta, which came out as Ramana Maharshi today in the 20th century, and Nisargadatta Maharaj, and surely influenced Nityananda, or at least he spoke in some of those terms. And we're seeing further intertwining between Gautama's teaching and the Vedas. Gautama took some of his teaching, or some of it is perfectly in line with Vedic. Later, those Vedic scholars and practitioners took some of what would you call this, medieval, early medieval, or late Indian Buddhism, 500 years to 1,000 years or so after Gautama's passing, you get these Vedantic scholars and yogis, such as Gaudapada, going on to Adi Shankara and his students, integrating what they found important in the Buddhist teachings back into Vedanta. And so Adi Shankara called Gaudapada a Param Guru. That's a high praise. He compiled what's called Mandukya Charika, Gaudapada Karika Charika, which is a teaching on Mandukya Upanishad. So we've got Vedic Upanishad, and then Gaudapada commenting on it in what's called Mandukya Charika. So we've got two different things there, the Upanishad and the Charika of Mandukya. And it's very interesting on the Wikipedia page. I can see that some of the people writing it up, contributing, wanted to make it clear, we're not Buddhist. And so the second line here is the text Mandukya Charika, his commentary on Mandukya Upanishad. The text consists of four chapters or four books, of which chapter four uses Buddhist terminology, thereby showing it was influenced by Buddhism, of course. However, doctrinally, Gaudapada's work is Vedantic, not Buddhist. Really? 25% of it is Buddhist. And it says the first three chapters, not the one that's Buddhist, have been influential in Advaita Vedanta tradition. That just, casts a bad light on the practitioners of Advaita Vedanta, who should use the whole thing. If the teacher writes four chapters, you probably should consider that all four are important. But this is saying the first three have been influential in Advaita Vedanta because they don't want what's Buddhist, perhaps. All right. So again, it's Gaudapada writing commentary on Mandukya Upanishad, which becomes Mandukya Karika or Charika. What is it? Down the page, Mr. Wikipedia tells me. Concise explanation in verse form of the doctrines of Mandukya Upanishad, one of the shortest Upanishads, just 12 sentences. So Mandukya Upanishad is small, the commentary is longer, and acquired higher value over the centuries, expressing Upanishadic essence or essence of spiritual teaching. And it gives a little overview sentence. The Charika, meaning Gaudapada's commentary on Mandukya Upanishad, presents rational arguments from dream states, infinitude, time and space, causality, disintegration, generation, in support of Advaita doctrine. Well, that's confusing. Basically, you've got four chapters where he's commenting on Mandukya Upanishad. And I won't. I think I'd like to go into the Upanishad first and swing around. The first thing I would like to actually say, this is not planned, so sorry if it's a little ragged. Many teachers' teachings use variant terms for the same reality or the same matter. Again and again and again, many words are used for the same, to describe the same object or the same phenomenon. It's just really tiresome, frankly, and it leads to a lot of confusion. So, from Gaudapada Charika 1:28-29, translated by Karl Potter from this page, the phrase here is Om is bliss. So, Om is Ananda. And it says Om is Brahman, both the higher and lower, as well as Ishvara, residing God, deity, residing in the hearts of everyone. It's both without measure and of unlimited measure. It's the cessation of duality. It's bliss. So these are, endless equivalences. Om is bliss or Ananda. Om is Brahman. So Brahman is Ananda. Brahman is Om. Brahman is and Om and Brahman and bliss. So Om, and you're going to see a lot of teachings about Om from Mandukya Upanishad. So what is Om? Om is the magic syllable, sacred syllable. Well, yeah, but it's considered basically the creation of create the generation of what we call a creation by infinity. The movement, the apparent movement of or generation of finity by infinity. It's the movement, it's let there be light. It's the generation of light. So Om is Brahman. Brahman is Godhead or the Logos or intelligent infinity. So now you have endless phrases that really point to the same. Om, you can say it's that syllable like pranava of Brahman or creator making light, making creation, but it's not different from creator, and thus the means by which infinity makes light is itself. It makes it by itself. So Om and pranava, syllable and phrase, generation of light, is not separate from the one that does that, which is called Brahman or intelligent infinity or the one infinite creator. And then that's the same as Ishvara residing in the hearts of everyone. That's called Atman. So Ishvara is also akin to Atman, which is really essentially not in essence or true nature different from Brahman or Logos or Om or Ananda. Intelligent infinity, one infinite creator from the raw material, Nibbana from Bodhidhamma, the deathless from Gautama, complete and perfect enlightenment, extinguishing of desire and ignorance and craving and identity, all the same, non-dual, inconceivable, ending of duality, bliss, and that's also residing in the hearts of everyone. That's in the raw material, Atman as a sub-sub logos to the Brahman of the Logos, which is a sub logos to the galactic, which is called the Logos. So galactic logos, solar sub logos, Atmanic sub sub logos, one logos. The creator is in the heart. Look in the mirror, see the creator. Look around you, see the creator. Look at things and people, see the creator, Ra said. All the same. All the same. And if you're going to tell me that that's, people who fight to say it's different and I'm better. It's different and we're better. These are just yellow ray blocked, souls. Now there is different and there is better and worse. But, using 100 words for non-duality means from multiple traditions. Or these are multiple traditions, Advaita Vedanta, Bodhidhamma, the raw material, using variant terms to point to the same realities. What is beyond the phenomenal, the source of the phenomenal, and the phenomenal, that the many is one, and that one is it cannot be is not a thing. Light is a dream too. So the creation is a dream too, and God is not outside, or source is not outside. All that is of its source. The true nature of all that is its creator. And so it's very clear to me these are three systems coming from the same understanding of source and creating, creation, and the polarity of light or light as creation that manifests as polarity and cycles and time and space, and apparent beings or apparently separate beings who are in some quite substantially real dukkha and would like to get out of it. So, but you've got here countless synonyms that should be understood as many ways, you know, the 10,000 names of God kind of thing. Yeah, Om is Ananda, which is Brahman, which is Ishvara, which is Atman, which is Advaita, which is Self with a capital S, which is the deathless, which is Nibbana, which is intelligent infinity, which is the one infinite, which creates, which is our source, which is true nature. Right? That seems very reasonable to me, and nobody needs to fight about it. So let's, if you agree with me, don't fight. If you disagree with me, have at it. So, okay, well, let's look at the time. 35, 36 even now. Let me jump over to Mandukya Upanishad. Again, I'm just looking, working from Wikipedia, but you know, I think we can riff on this. The shortest of all Upanishads, assigned to Atharva Veda, number 6 in the Muktika canon of 108 Upanishads. 108 is an important number in Buddhism also. In prose, 12 short verses, which is 12 lines really, associated with a Rig Vedic school, discusses the syllable Om, which as we just see, Om is Ananda, Om is Brahman, Om is Ishvara, Om is Atman. You know, the nature of Jiva is Atman, and the nature of Jivatman is Paramatman, and the nature of Paramatman is Brahma or Satchitananda, and that's the logos and all that. So discussing Om is discussing source, the unity of source and manifestation, the identity that source, infinity, and manifestation, duality and manyness is one. So it discusses Om, which is like discussing everything, and presents the theory of four states of consciousness and asserts that Om is Brahman, which is the whole, and that Brahman is the self, Atman. There you go. Om as pranava, as the expression of source that generates light and galaxies and physical phenomenal creation, time and space. And then the energy fields and conscious or sentient light. See, light is sentient. And so it naturally coalesces into selfhood or identity. The self is a, you know, the experience of a self is an inevitable coalescence of light, self-reflective. Light always ever vibrating. Vibrates to in a way of a kind of self-reflective, it vibrates in a kind of self-reflective way, or its vibration is intrinsically self-reflective because there's nothing but light. You create light, that's all you got, light. So it vibrates and then reflects upon itself because that's all there is, and that generates identity, and that's the eighth fetter, and that's where everything comes out of. Then you have that identity intrinsically craving, and by craving, intrinsically going into dukkha, and then by its limited perception, experiencing, imagining it, you know, experiencing apparent substantiality, which is really not, and apparent stability, which is really not. And so, these teachings of Anicca Anatta Dukkha is sort of the first level de-reification, or the first level. Smack us out of wrong beliefs, wrong view. And the second level is to smack, second level meaning tatata, you know, sunya, tatata, atamyata, smacks us out of any substantializing or reification of the three marks. The phenomena are neither permanent nor impermanent. This one here is neither a self nor a no self. And the quality of experience is neither eternally pleasurable nor eternally painful. All of these conceivings are sunya. Yet reality is doing these conceivings and seeing their emptiness, and that's ta-ta-ta. So, okay, and you can say that it's Om and it's Brahman, and the point is that the source and its generation is one. Look into the mirror, see the creator. Same. So let's look further. Mandukya is sometimes in Sanskrit written as Manduka, Dukkha-Dukkha. Sanskrit etymology and scholarship is really a challenge. It could mean frog or a breed of horse or spiritual distress. So it's the frog Upanishad, whatever. Or Manduka can also mean Vedic school. So, right. Whatever it is, one scholar says it's a half-lost school of Rig Veda. I'm not familiar with all these things, but whatever that may be, whatever the etymology of the term Mandukya, let's look at the teaching. And again, the dating is also contested, meaning when was it written? It seems that some people date it to the early centuries of the Common Era, so 0 to 300 AD, first or second century AD. Some people will date it in the 5th and 4th century BCE, meaning soon after Gautama. So I think clearly, one scholar says the Mandukya Upanishad is listed before and about the time of the first Buddhist Pali and Jain canonical texts when they were composed, which would have been 300, 200, 100 AD or BC, several hundred years after Gautama, not 500 BC, but 300, 200 or so BC. So again, this is the first millennium after Gautama, and there were arhats around and pure understanding of teaching, and heavy distortion had not yet crept into Buddhism. So one can trust 500 BC to 500 AD quite comfortably, I'd say. Okay. And it interestingly says chronological roots. The foundation of several theories or teachings in Mandukya Upanishad are found chronologically in more ancient Sanskrit texts. Chandogya Upanishad, which is one of the oldest Upanishads, number 9 of the 108, also discusses four states of consciousness: awaking, dream-filled sleep, deep sleep, and beyond deep sleep. And again, we're talking about levels of knowing. These are human experiences that reveal deeper, or may well reveal deeper levels of meaning and understanding, deeper levels of knowing associated with these four states to help us be free of of dukkha and get out of illusion and return to source. Okay, and so this integration here, the text of Mandukya Upanishad is fully incorporated in the Mandukya Charika from Gaudapada. And that again is about 500, some, the mid 6th century, meaning 500 or so plus 550 AD. And it's not known, it's interesting, not known to exist independent of this commentary. And then some people reasonably presume that Gaudapada wrote Mandukya Upanishad and then commented on it. That's cool. He wrote the Upanishad himself and then commented on it himself. That's, however, a minority view. most people is shown here consider Mandukya Upanishad as a principal Upanishad with more ancient origins. But of course, humans like to argue, and a lot of things are unclear, actually, very unclear. So, contents. Mandukya Upanishad they wrote, particularly important to Advaita Vedanta, presents particularly certain doctrines, namely, quote, universe is Brahman, the self, Atma, exists and is Brahma. And it exists doesn't mean separate from infinity. I mean, infinity exists. However, since it's not a thing, it's really beyond existing or non-existing. Okay? So, to say God exists is cool, I would say, yeah, sure, you can say it, but that's a shallow understanding. Deeper than that, I mean, what is the nature of God or Source? Well, up to you. But intelligent infinity or infinity of power and awareness and capacity is pretty reasonable. Does that exist? Well, can wholly immaterial exist? It's existing in mind. Whose mind? It is its own mind, which is infinite. So, all sorts of that's is why Nagarjuna talked about the middle way or understanding Buddha Dharma, because we're getting into Sanskrit at that point, is neither affirmation nor negation. You can't affirm. All that is affirmed or negated is conceptual, and reality is transconceptual. It's achintya, inconceivable. It's actually inconceivability. It's beyond the arising of the capacity for conceiving. Meanwhile, it is. So, ta-ta-ta. And its power is boundless because the infinite creation, the infinite galaxies, came from something, It didn't come from nothing. It came from something, but it's not a thing. It came from a source. It didn't arise out of no source. Manifestation arises or appears. What was before the appearance of galaxies? Obviously, God, or Logos, or Brahman, or Paramatman, whatever you want to call it, a thousand names. One infinite creator, intelligent infinity, cosmic awareness, infinite awareness. So, humans confuse themselves, they trip over their shoelaces doctrinally. Because they don't want to realize that they've used 100 different words for the same thing, which is not a thing. And then they argue, because ultimately some people are more interested in organizational power, political power, than they are in liberation or freedom. But there have been absolutely pure, true yogis all over the place, certainly in the Vedantic, yogic, Patanjali, and then Advaita Vedanta traditions and Buddha Dhamma, all three schools, of course. So we're trying to work with words to see the identity of many variant terms and not get stuck in our argument, obviously. So, okay, Mandukya Upanishad presents several theories about Om and that it symbolized self. So, again, self with a capital S is not. The self is not a substantial identity. That's the point. Self with a capital S, as far as I can tell, I'm not finished with the path, so I'm just looking and surmising. If self with a capital S is Brahman or Paramatman or Godhead or infinity, then it's clearly not a separative, substantial, personal self. That's why they put a capital letter to it. And so I would surely say that capital S self as Paramatman, one with Brahman, what the where the individual self ends up after this octave is at one with the infinite source. Maybe not finished with the work, but knowing and living at one-ment with Source. And that's the deathless, because it's not a thing that is born to die. Okay, Om in Mandukya Upanishad, and I went into this a bit last time, and I guess time flying, I'll get into it more. It's very interesting. Mandukya Upanishad is actually quite a happy document. It starts out by declaring, Om, this syllable is the whole world, meaning the whole creator, the one infinite creator is all. Thereafter, it presents various explanations and theories on what it means and signifies, and then you get all sorts of complications because they got to fill out the book, or they have some parchment to use. They bought it or they bartered. They got to use it. If you just say Om exclamation mark, Nityananda, 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 you can't make a book of it. You can't make a school of it. You might have wasted the coconut. Or whatever it was that got you the parchment and the colored liquid to write it on, to write upon it. Om as all states of time. Again, Om as bliss, Om as Brahman, Om as infinite creator. The doing of infinity is infinity, and there's no separation. Ra said, Don asked Ra, first session, what's your purpose? Ra said, we are those of the Law of One, that is our nature and our purpose. The identity, unity, between what we call two things, called a nature of a being and its purpose in its activity. Its activity that has a purpose, its purpose-based activity, and the being that is the one doing the purpose-based, the purposeful activity. That appears as a two, but it's a one. And the nature of the one is sunya, so it's an infinite, or a boundless, or an inconceivable. That's the point. So Om, as all states of time, means that Brahman, one infinite creator, intelligent infinity, is the nature of all time. Om, as all states of Atman. They could have also said space. Time and space go together. This is the framework for soul evolution, seven dimensional octaves that appear to be. I mean, what the hell is time anyway? It's just the result of limited perception of a falsely believed separative identity. Om is all states of Atman, so that what Ra calls higher self or Atman, sixth density sublogos or sublogos. Is its true nature is one with logos. So Brahman, and it says Om is all states of Atman. Brahman is the whole. This is verse 2. Brahman is the self, Atman. Brahman is the self consisting of four corners. Well, it doesn't. It there may be an appearance of a tetrad or a quadrant. That's another matter. So Om as Pranava. The letting there be light, the syllable that both embodies its source and manifests purposeful intention, activity of source, making creation, making light. Creation as light, light as the true nature of all energy, right? The origin, the true nature of all energy, the nature of all energy is light, said Ra, and the origin of that energy is action of free will upon love. The action of Brahman or intelligent infinity or one infinite creator, its action is its purposeful activity, is its activity that has a purpose, which is letting there be light, or let there be a creation, which is Om or Pranava. But that Om and Pranava, the vok, VOC, the speaking of infinity, is Om or Pranava. And its nature is not different than the nature of the one that speaks, or vok, or lets there be light, or makes this action of free will upon love, infinite will upon infinite love, generating infinite light, near infinite light. So, Om as all states of Atman. The true nature of our true nature. So, if the human personality is outer, higher self is inner, And secret is the fact that that true nature of our true nature of Atman, is Om, which is Om Tat Sat. Right. Is Brahman, which is God, which is infinity, which is. I think at that point you probably. You can say self with a capital S. Yeah, there is something possibly limiting. You see, self with a capital S is also medicinal. And so infinity is neither of a self nor a not self. It's beyond any of that. So that's a little different. Anyway, Om is all states of time. Om is all states of Atman. Source of Atman is Atman. Atman is Paramatman. The true nature of Atman is Paramatman. Just as the true nature of Jiva is Atman, knowing that is Jnani or Jnana and becomes a Jnani. And that's Jivatman. And the true nature of that is Paramatman. And the true nature of that is Brahman. And that's intelligent infinity. Om is all states of consciousness, meaning. All awareness is its true nature is source too. And that's where you get the four states of consciousness: wakeful, dream, deep sleep, and then dreamless sleep, which is also here written as ekatma, being one with self, oneness of self. This notion is that dreamless sleep is union of jivanatman. Is basically kind of a experience of unity where I'm not sure about that. You can say that, but who the hell knows, because there's no conceiving. You're conceiving a non-conceptual, you're conceiving an experience of non-conceiving and conceiving it as the final liberated awareness. I'm not sure about that. Then Om as all of etymological knowledge. And that's when you get into the scholars with a very thin nose, a very bony nose. Bony, beaky nose and thin lips people enjoy Om as all of etymological knowledge, how the A and the U and the M is the basis of the whole alphabet in Sanskrit or something. But the key, if you're still with me here, then the next section is the four states of consciousness. And that's really. The heart of Mandukya Upanishad is a discussion of these four states and how their nature and their nature. But if we understand Om as the four states, all states of consciousness, then these states reveal have the promise for the sincere seeker, for the yogi. To reveal, increasingly reveal reality and source, levels of knowledge, outer, inner, secret, these four states can be used very cleverly, not clever, not as strategic, by very nimble consciousness can use the four states to penetrate further levels of knowing. Penetrate into further levels of knowing, basically generating finer states that are set aside. Seeing not only anicca anatta dukkha but also sunya of the finer states, and how these are states and they're not states, or the states, the nature of all states of consciousness is empty too. Meaning its true nature is free of all our conceiving. So what is it? I don't know. I can't conceive it. So it goes on. Mandukya Upanishad describes three states of consciousness and then a fourth, namely waking, dreaming, deep sleep, which I think is dreamless sleep, and then, quote, the fourth, beyond and underlying the three. And the fourth is Nityananda spoke of this, you say. So while Nityananda wouldn't really be classed as an Advaita Vedanta yogi, or Paramguru. He spoke of these teachings of the four states that associate with Mandukya Upanishad and Gaudapada, who is basically, in some sense, the Paramguru of Advaita Vedanta. if Adi Shankara is, 1400 years ago, taken as a root guru by 20th century Advaita Vedanta yogis, who did he take his param guru? He took it as Gaudapada. And Gaudapada may have written the Mandukya Upanishad, but surely gave essential commentary on it. And that's considered one of the prin to me, it's one of the principal Upanishads. And so here you get Nityananda talking about Turiya, the fourth state, even though he's not, he said his understanding is Paramatman, which, the goal is also could be called Paramatman, which is the same as Satchitananda, which is Nityananda, meaning not anicca, but nitya, meaning endless ananda, bliss, which is intelligent infinity or the state, the emotional portion, the emotional experience of at one with infinity, I would imagine, kind of endless bliss, nitya, ananda. But he's not strictly an Advaita Vedanta teacher, Nityananda, but he spoke about the four states from Mandukya Upanishad. So the first state is the waking state, in which we're aware of our daily world. Quote, it's described as outward knowing, gross and universal. This is the gross body. How gross. So the body and the state correlate. A dimension is a composite, is of sentient light, the sentient light of beings. If there are no beings, are there no dimensions? Yeah, it seems. A planet may be a place where you can take a spaceship to and from, and it exists whether you get there or not. But it's only when there are beings of a certain level that that level actually stabilizes. The planet has 7 dimensions available, but only when human beings evolve to a certain level over time does the latent do higher dimensional spheres, energy fields actualize. It goes from potential to kinetic or potential to actual. The dimensions actualize by beings' evolution. Hell is not rightly thought of as a place, an astral place. It's rightly thought of as a place, an apparent place, coincidental or synchronous with the consciousness of beings of a certain spectrum of awareness, particularly hate and lust and great pain. The level, the loka is in many ways the vijnana of the beings therein. So the outer is made by the dimensional locations. That too is a deceptive, mistaken phrasing or perception, conception, experience, that dimension is a place. It is a place, but it's only established by the consciousness of beings within a certain spectrum, a certain band of light, a certain band of consciousness, band of light associated with a certain band of consciousness, if you know what I mean. So to say that the first state is the gross body is to say that embody, day waking consciousness, which is wholly associated with I'm here in this body, and you and everything else is out there beyond the body in the physical environment, inner, outer, subject, object. That is of the body, but it's also the body of the mind, meaning the body, this body is made by this consciousness that is at a third chakra level in some sense. Yellow ray body is yellow ray consciousness. And the yellow ray or yellow, third dimension in which you have yellow ray physical fleshy bodies is not separate in any way. It co-arises with the apparent beings therein of yellow ray consciousness or self-consciousness, one step up from the animals. So you've got a the three is a one. The beings with their consciousness, the physical environment, and the dimensional level is one. So the body is made by the mind, and the body mind of that apparent being makes the apparent outer environment or dimension in which that embodied mind exists or lives.
All
Right, if you're still with me without a headache or something, that's really good. And I won't go through the time as ran as I run. The first state, just a overview, and then we'll get into this. This is where we'll start next week, the four states. First state, waking state, is the gross body. Second state is the dreaming mind. This is the subtle body. So the dreaming mind is the subtle body. The waking state of five sense, six sense perception, physical dualistic awareness is the gross body. The body is the state, is the being of a certain level, a certain spectrum of light or range of consciousness. The second state is the subtle body state of consciousness, and the body energy field is associated with dreaming. Then the third, called the state of deep sleep, is the causal body. The causal body, which we'll get into that all. I'm not, I'm learning along the way too. This is dreamless. I'm not sure about dreamless sleep versus deep sleep. I think what they mean is, yeah, it's dreamless sleep. Maybe susupti. There are again many different terms they use, they're in different Sanskrit for the same. But the third is this deep sleep, which is the causal body or energy field, which is a consciousness of beings in that quote deep sleep or dreamless sleep, causal body energy field vibration. And the final is for Turiya the fourth. That's what we all like, is Turiya the fourth. Written here as the background that underlies and transcends the three common states of consciousness. In this consciousness, or freedom, both absolute relative are transcended. It's considered the true state of experience of the infinite and non-different, free from dualist experience, which results from attempts to conceptualize vikalpa, kalpa, kalpana, reality. It's the state in which ajitivada, non-origination, is apprehended. Non-origination sounds like the deathless to me. The birthless is the deathless, non-arising. The non-arising of subjective consciousness, and thus subjective consciousness, based perceiving, subject-object perceiving, only happens when there's a continuance of a supposed subject, subjective consciousness, a so-called self. For the eighth fetter not yet broken. When it's broken, that's the end of perception, because perception is intrinsically arising from a subjectivity. And so the end of the subjectivity, seeing through it, it's not death, it's the death of illusion. Seeing through the finer state of the true nature, the constituents of subjectivity. How is it that there is subjectivity? The arising of subjectivity, the arising of vijnana. What's that? Seen through, set aside, isn't the loss of a reality, it's the loss of an illusion. But it's also the ending of perception, which is not the ending of experience, it's the ending of subjective, dualistic, illusion, ignorance-based perceiving, dual perceiving. In non-duality, there's no perceiving. But there is life. And that'll be where we end for today. So, ajativada, non-origination. You're going to tell me that that's different from the deathless? Really? So I hope this was useful. Fun for me. My head is not stressed. It's nice. Good head, man, as they say. I hope you're well. Take good care of yourself. The world is a total mess. Humanity is smashing its head against the wall as it commonly does. 3D repeaters can't do self-improvement consistently, it seems. So, we bless them, love them, and the caravan rolls on. Take good care. See you next time. Good night.